let me just clear out the screen. Let me just talk about a few more properties of these transactions next. Okay, so, you know, I'd mentioned earlier that transactions don't lead to deadlocks, right? And this happens because, you know, both transactions are executing in parallel, right? So when you get to the start of a transaction, it's not as if you're acquiring a lock and holding on to a resource, right? You're allowing everybody else to proceed at the same time. And the first transaction to reach the end is going to get to commit, right? So we are guaranteed of making forward progress because, you know, somebody is going to get to the end of the transaction first, and that transaction is going to get permissions from the arbiter to commit. And so we know that that transaction for sure is going to finish successfully and move on, right? So we're guaranteed forward progress, and there is no possibility of a deadlock in this particular implementation of transactional memory. Okay, but there are other bad things that can happen. Okay, so for example, you know, this cache brought in block A, okay, and you've set the read bit. And at some point, you know, maybe this block has to get evicted, right? So, you know, maybe the transaction is very long and touches enough blocks that there isn't enough capacity in the cache, right? Even these capacity pressures need not exist, right? The transaction could be short, but if there's an unusual amount of conflicts for that set, this block may eventually get evicted. Okay, now when a block gets evicted, even if, so if you happen to have read this block within the transaction, okay, it's possible that in the future, you may get something on the bus that says somebody else did a write into A. Okay, so you still have to check against all of these blocks to see, you know, do I have to abort myself? You know, did I read this block at some point? In which case, I have to abort myself. Okay, so even though this block is not in cache, I still have to somehow record the fact that I have touched, you know, A, B, C. You know, these are blocks that no longer sit in cache. They have been evicted, but these are blocks that I did touch within my transaction, and this transaction is not yet finished. Okay, so if I see a write to it, I should check against this list, and I need to abort if there is a match against my list. Okay, so there are many ways to implement this. You can keep a signature of all blocks that have been evicted, and I won't go into those details right now, but there are multiple ways to handle, you know, these blocks being evicted out of my cache. Okay, one simple technique which can be used in many different settings is to acquire a token that allows you to commit in the future. Okay, so I mentioned before that there is an arbiter, and before you commit, you have to contact this arbiter and, you know, get permissions to commit. So this arbiter is basically handing out a single token which allows one transaction to commit at a time. Okay, so if you have to overflow from your cache, one option is to contact the arbiter and say that, you know, I'm going to be the next transaction to commit, right? I have not yet reached the end of my transaction, but, you know, since I'm overflowing out of my cache, since I have to make my changes permanent at this point of time, I'm just going to acquire the token and be the next transaction to commit. Okay, so this essentially locks everybody else from committing their own transactions, right? They can still make forward progress, but when they get to the end and when they try to do their commit, they won't be able to do it until this first transaction performs its commit and releases the token back to the arbiter. Okay, so, you know, this is almost like degenerating into a lock-based scenario where at a time only one thread is making progress because it holds the lock and everybody else is being forced to wait. Okay, so when you have really long transactions, your behavior is not going to be as well because, you know, some transaction is going to acquire this token and it's going to act as if, you know, this thread holds a lock and everybody else is being forced to wait until this lock is released. Okay, so, you know, let's look at some other bad scenarios that could happen, you know, with these transactions. Okay, so you can certainly have starvation. So let me show you how that would happen. So let's assume that this transaction over here is extremely long, and the first thing it does is maybe it reads the value of B. Okay, and this other core is executing a while loop. Okay, and within this while loop, there's a very short transaction that's being executed. And over here, there's a write to B that always happens. Okay, so this transaction starts off, it brings in the block B. The block B is marked as having been read. And then in the second transaction, as soon as you do a write to B, and then you get to your transaction commit, you know, because this transaction is finished first, it acquires the token and then it starts broadcasting all of its writes. Okay, so it ends up sending an invalidate to this transaction saying, I've modified B. If you have read B, you need to abort and restart. Okay, so this gets aborted, restarts, and then, you know, when it restarts again, it reads B, and, you know, soon after that, because there's a while loop over here, this transaction goes back up over here, you know, gets into the transaction, finishes, again tells everybody that I've modified B, again this transaction gets aborted, restarts, right? So here's a really large transaction that never gets to its end because, you know, before it does that, some other short transaction is finishing, and if it has modified a block that I have touched, I keep getting aborted. Okay, so one way to handle this is for this transaction to realize that, you know, I have been aborted, let's say 20 times, and once that happens, I say that, well, you know, I'm being stopped. So let me, you know, before I get to the end of the transaction, let me just contact the central arbiter. Let me get that token to commit. And this ensures that, you know, until I finish over here, nobody else can commit, right? So this transaction, even though it has finished, it just sits there and waits until it gets permission from the arbiter to proceed with its commit. Okay, so this transaction gets to its very end. It performs all of its operations, and then it releases the token back to the arbiter, and that allows the second transaction to finish, right? So this is obviously not an ideal scenario because only one transaction is making progress and everybody else is being forced to wait. So the behavior kind of degenerates to the point of, you know, me using locks, right? That token is like having acquired a lock. And so, you know, this is not the best behavior, but it's perhaps no worse than the performance that you would see if you had used a lock-based version of your code. Okay, but, you know, this is again a clean way to handle something bad that could happen in transactions, you know, something like overflows or starvation and so on. Okay, so this is my basic implementation, and let me just walk through the next few slides to make sure that I've covered all these points. As I said before, there is no possibility of a deadlock because at least one transaction is guaranteed to commit. The first one that reaches the end of the transaction is guaranteed to be able to commit. Okay, so there's no possibility of a deadlock. You have high performance because a transaction is forced to abort and restart only if there is a conflict, only if the two transactions have touched the same values and at least one of them is a write. Okay, so the performance is going to be high if the two transactions are touching completely different data. And this entire program was relatively easy to program because all you had to do was introduce, you know, coarse-grained transactions. You didn't have to go and introduce transactions at every fine-grained point. All you had to do is find the region of code that deals with shared data and encapsulate that entire region within a large transaction.